Welcome to week three. I realize that I managed to give you another bunch of articles to read. It will slow down. In fact, you'll see at the end that I assign a bit less for the coming week. I think that part of what's going on is that I'm eager to get everyone the background for naming so that we can move on to other, even more difficult aspects of language. So here are just some things, introductory things that everybody needs to know. We did discuss this when we met last Tuesday, but if you weren't there or if you'd just like a review, here it is. So first of all, get used to the idea that using single quotation marks indicates the word itself. So the word word has four letters, or the word hell has four letters, right? So these four-letter words are indicated to be words by the single quotation marks. Double quotation marks are for sentences that people say. So when you're quoting them or noting that a person said this or uttered this, you use double quotations. Italics are used for to denote, ha ha ha, to denote thoughts or concepts in the mind or ideas. So italics are generally, not perfectly, but generally used for cognitive content. In the readings and in this class, we're talking about language, and there's a large distinction that is made between sentences and propositions. Propositions are meaningful claims. Sentences are instances of propositions. So the proposition, for example, might be Judy walked the dog. There are different sentences that portray that same proposition, that same meaningful content. So I can say sentence one, Judy walked the dog, or sentence two, the dog was walked by Judy, right? Same cognitive content, different phrasing, different arrangement of words, so different sentences. The sentences are thought to be more like instances. Propositions are thought to be these, basically these metaphysical objects that are content holders or meaning holders. There are three, sorry, I lost it. There are three main branches of philosophy of language. They are syntax, semantics, and pragmatics. You have probably noticed already that we focus on semantics. Most interesting philosophical questions in philosophy of language are about meaning, though we can, of course, ask about syntax or the structure and conjugation rules of a language, and we can also ask questions of pragmatics, that is, how a language is used. So kind of keep in mind that we hover in the realm of semantics and a little bit in pragmatics, and we do a little bit less syntax, though that's involved as well. As you have probably noticed, everything that we are talking about in this class is some intersection of language and metaphysics or ontological claims and ideas in the mind or concepts in the mind or mental contents or our understanding of something. I had another question this week that was, are there any women in this field? And I do need to confess that really this is a very male-dominated field, but we are going to read some women. We're going to read Lyra Boroditsky, Ruth Barkin Marcus, and Ruth Milliken, and these are all giants in the field as well, but they have not done this primitive work on names. So we're starting with names, so we're starting with boys, but we'll get to the girls soon enough. Another comment that I got this week that I wanted to address is that there is this connection, as I'm sure you've seen in the readings, between logic and language. And it's absolutely true that people can use language even if they are being illogical, but that doesn't mean that the language they use has no internal structure or has no internal logic, if you will. This especially comes out in the writings of Bertrand Russell and the writings of Noam Chomsky. So it's definitely more there than it is in the writings of, say, Donnellan or Milliken, though even Donnellan and Milliken are concerned with the syntax or the internal rule structure of a language. So people can be illogical and still use language, and that does not mean that language itself is illogical. People have been asking me about different topics that we will cover in this course, so I give you just a sketch on this slide. I'm not going to read through the whole thing, you can read, but it gives you an idea of the different kinds of things that we will be talking about as the semester progresses. But first, we have to finish with names. As you've probably noticed, names are really hard. By the way, I really want to commend everyone by telling you I am so happy with how the discussions are going, and I especially want to mention James, Todd, Catlin, Alex, and Mercer. Thank you so much for how heavily you have contributed to the discussion. You're doing exactly what I want you to do in this class. The Santa Claus question was an incredibly difficult question, and I'm so happy to read through it all and see how involved people are getting and how muddy you realize the water is because you're giving counter proposals to each other and because you're critiquing each other's views and responding to that. That names, which seem to be the simplest thing in language, they're actually incredibly complex. So I really appreciate everyone rolling up their sleeves and digging into the dirt with just how hard names are. So you've been digging for a while, and Russell comes to try to help us out with his theory of definite descriptions. So I'm going to give you a quick summary of on denoting with a little tip of my hat to the other article, the descriptions article. So Russell comes up with a theory that is kind of based on Frege's theory in some ways, but it also goes against Frege's theory in other ways. It's called definite descriptions. Proper names are abbreviations for a long list of descriptions of properties and attributes of the named object. So a name is like code that, if expanded, would be very, very long and contain all of the descriptions that you would use in order to definitely or definitively pick out a thing. Russell claims that this solves Frege's puzzle without appealing to these weird, mysterious senses. We don't need to have senses when we have definite descriptions. What's going on in the difference between A equals A and A equals B, right? Why is one completely tautologous and the other one surprising? It's because we've attached different descriptions to A and to B. And so the descriptions map on exactly when it's A equals A, but there are differences in the descriptions when A equals B. So that's how we get Frege's puzzle, and that's also how we solve Frege's puzzle. We do not have to appeal to these mysterious senses. As you see in the reading overall, these are just some general points. Russell talks about both the indefinite article, so a or an, versus the definite article, the. The makes the thing named completely unambiguous. And so this is where he starts getting into the logical language of saying one and only one, which should remind you of if and only if, and so on. Russell bases this notion of definite descriptions on his idea of what knowledge is. So if you've had epistemology or philosophy of science with Prashanto, you've bumped into knowledge by acquaintance and knowledge by description before. Russell argues elsewhere that there are only two ways that human beings know things. This should feel like your old rationalist empiricist debate from the history of philosophy. Knowledge by acquaintance is when we've directly experienced something. Knowledge by description is when we use words in order to understand something that we can never observe. So knowledge by acquaintance is basically empiricism. Knowledge by description is something like rationalism, but with a lot of language involved. And so, given that this is Russell's structure of our cognitive contents of our knowledge, if we don't grab a thing directly, like by pointing to it, right, by using indexicals like this chair right here and that yacht over there, right, if we're not using indexicals, which would give us knowledge by acquaintance, then we are using knowledge by description. So we are defining our terms and we are describing extensively every object so that we can pick it out uniquely. What else do I want to tell you? So another part of the backdrop for Russell is that language conveys meaning. So everything going on in a language is somehow mental. This is all about stuff that goes on in your head. One of Russell's great examples, I just wanted to put this on the slide, even though it's a little disconnected, is his great example is, I thought my yacht was longer than it is. And on the one hand, this is right something that people might say, oh, I thought my yacht was longer than it is. On the other hand, this is the most idiotic, tautologous, silly thing to say, like, how could you ever think that your yacht is longer than it is? That's sort of like saying, I thought that A didn't equal A, which you never did. You never thought that. You always think with the principle of identity. You might think that A does not equal B, and that might be mistaken, but you never think that A does not equal A, and you never really think, I thought my yacht was longer than it is. So Russell is very apt and very funny with these cute little sentences in order that he provides to us so that we have examples of how tricky language can be. And he does battle with this notion of tautology, just as Frege does. So Russell invents quantificational calculus in order to express the meanings of propositions in a clear and refined way. So he takes propositional meanings to be all about having existential quantifiers. So if I say the cat is on the mat, what I am saying is there exists a cat, and that cat is on a mat, and that mat also exists, and the cat is not identical to the mat. Aha, right? So suddenly you have a long, long quantificational logic sentence that expresses the cat is on the mat. Language is made up of quantifiers like all and there exists, and variables like cat, this cat, spit cat, Anya cat, moon cat, and whichever mat. And if you want to name the mat, you can do that too. So I've got a little bit of quotation from On Denoting showing you how much Russell sees language as being logical. So, and he's looking again, as Frege does, at the relationship between the meaning of a sentence and the truth of a sentence. And Russell really wants to recognize that false sentences can be meaningful. So one of the things that he's trying to do in On Denoting is talk about empty names, which we've been doing battle with all week, or fictional names like Santa Claus or unicorns. Other people, especially Mill, is going to be forced into saying that they have no meaning at all. Frege even has to say that false names that don't denote anything denote the null class, so they actually denote zero or nothingness. And that's a really bizarre, because Santa Claus and unicorns, that really seemed, those words really seem to have a different sort of mental contents than nothingness, right? So we're not talking about nothingness when we talk about Santa Claus. And Russell mentions Meinong, who's someone who we won't read. He's very weird. He's a modal logician, and he's one of these folks in modal logic who believes that every single possible reality is actual. So if you are into physics and branching universes, Meinong is totally your guy. So he thinks that every name that is empty in this universe is full in another possible universe. And those are the reasons why we can speak of Santa Claus and Robin Hood and Batman and so forth. We can speak of them because they actually exist in some other possible reality. So Russell disagrees both with Frege and with Meinong. That's why he develops this theory of definite descriptions. Page 485 is the page with the cash money, and he's bringing us his very famous view: the present king of France is bald is a sentence that is false. And if you translate it into quantificational calculus, you will come to understand exactly why it is false, because it makes two claims. It makes a claim that there exists a present king of France, and it makes a claim that that specific and unique person is not hirsute. Here's another one of Russell's fantastic jokes. Right, he picks on the Hegelians on this page, saying, you know, if you were prone to trying to resolve this issue through synthesis, you would say that the present king of France wears a wig, but that is in fact not the case. The sentence is false. It is false because there is no present king of France. So it's not about whether or not he has hair. It's about the fact that the present king of France does not exist at all. I'm going to click through and move on to the next.